My name is Liz. I'm the executive director of AFAB Humane Society. I sent all the emails. I sent a lot of emails. But thank you guys so much for coming and joining us. I want to also thank Middlesex Bank for sponsoring this and getting Kelly here today. Coffee, munchkins, water over there. Bathrooms are downstairs. I mean, feel free to come and go if you need to run out. And
no, you're not allowed to go.
You're not allowed to go. I don't like
sit. Stay.
I gotta tell you, like, you know, I don't know. I was really glad to see the incredible like response. I actually like stopped advertising it because we got such a good turnout. And I knew the room and I wanted it not to be like too packed in, but I don't know if anyone's familiar with her, and I'll let her talk about her background, obviously, but this woman is incredible. I mean, she is one of the best in the country, so we're all very, you are, I mean, she is one of the best. Like, behaviorists, there are trainers, and that's a whole other level, but she's an incredible behaviorist who, I'll just let her take it from here, but this is really an honor. Like, we're all geeked out, all the AFAB staff. She's been a huge help to us before, too, but we're very lucky to have her, so thank you.
So, yeah, I want to thank BayPath for bringing me and our funder for sure. Thank you so much. And thank you guys for getting up on a Sunday morning to learn more about your dogs. I want to start by asking you a good question. How many are here because your dog's behavior is annoying you? Anne's got 15 hands. She's got 15 dogs.
I am not.
Okay, so I am an animal behaviorist. I work with private pet owners that are experiencing behavior problems with their cats and dogs, and work with both. I also consult with animal shelters all around the country, which is why BayPath knows me. And I used to work in the zoo field, little history there. I used to work in the zoo field. I worked with primates specifically. My graduate degree is in primate behavior. So I know how to deal with all of you guys. Don't worry, I'm just gonna let you get out of control. So I have a lot to share with you today, so I'm not gonna, you know, go on and on about myself. I wanna teach you today about your dog, because really understanding why your dog does the things they do is really critical, because a lot of times people who don't understand their dog respond to things that actually make it worse. So a lot of times when I'm consulting with a pet owner, they have made it worse, and they say, did we do this? And I'm like, yeah. You know, you don't create the problem, but you can make it worse when you don't understand it. So I really want to try to help you understand your dog better. So I'm going to go ahead and just get rolling, and I'm probably going to get to whatever it is you're struggling with. And if I don't, because I'm not going to talk about serious behavior problems like aggression and like severe anxieties and stuff, we're going to talk about, you know, why dogs do what they do, generally speaking. But certainly afterwards, if you have questions, we'll have a question period, and we'll just, you know, I'll try to answer any question you have. Okay, sound good? Everybody ready to roll? Yeah. Can everybody see okay?
Yep.
Can everybody hear okay? Am I talking loud enough? Back room? Back row? Okay. So let's go ahead and get started. So we know that we love our dogs, right? How many of you in here love your dogs? Okay. And we certainly know that they love us. How many people think their dog loves them? Yeah, of course they love us, right? But sometimes their behaviors can be kind of annoying, okay? So I love these things, you know, online that people put up now. So this one says, I went into my mom's purse while she was asleep, ate a tube of bright red lipstick, and chewed up three $1 bills. Anyway, we know that dogs sometimes do things that annoy us. Part of the problem is because they're dogs and we're people and we don't really understand their behavior. So we'll start by just talking generally on, you know, what behavior is. Basically, behavior is everything. It's everything an animal does. Every action, every reaction is behavior. Are you guys behaving right now?
Yes.
Yes, you are really behaving. You're sitting, you're listening, you're thinking, you're learning, you're twitching, you know? And so, yes, you are learning, you are behaving right now. Now, there are three major influences to any behavior. So anything you see your dog do, these three things are influencing that. The three major influences are the genetic makeup of the dog, the environment in which the dog is at the moment that it's behaving, and what that dog has learned in its life or in that environment. And all three of these influences are really, really important because they are what gives us behavior. And they're all interconnected because animals are genetically programmed to learn from their environment. Okay, but knowing they're all interconnected, I'm going to now separate them and talk a little bit more detail about each one. The genetics part. So the behaviors that we call inherited or innate behaviors are the ones I'm talking about, the genetically based behaviors. And the thing about an animal, once it's born into the world, we obviously can't change its genetic makeup, right? Here it is, it's alive. We can't go in there and tweak its genes. And that means that certain behavioral tendencies that are genetically based are really difficult to alter in a dog. And the thing about dogs more than any other animal is that we have influenced their behavior a great deal through selective breeding. Okay? So we humans have created the domestic dog, and we have created all the different breeds, from the tiniest little chihuahua all the way up to the giant bull mastiff and everything in between. So we created these animals. And a lot of times when we first started creating breeds, we created them to serve a purpose for us. Okay, so we tweaked their genetics so that they would do something for us. For example, the guarding dogs. The guarding dogs are genetically programmed to guard, right? To guard our territory, to be protective. That means they're more reactive. That's in their genetic code, because we've tweaked it so that they act like that. The herding dogs are the same way. We created the herding dogs to help us herd our livestock. And so they're genetically predisposed to herding. If you have a border collie in your home and you don't have sheep in your backyard, your border collie doesn't just say, oh, I guess I'm a lab. Your border collie is going to start chasing the kids. It's going to start nipping at people's heels when they try to leave the house. It's going to start chasing cars and bikes. Might even develop this weird obsessive compulsive shadow chasing thing because their brain is genetically prepared to herd things. We created the retrievers. And the retrievers, of course, are genetically programmed to pick stuff up and bring it to you. And so that's why your lab meets you at the door with a shoe in his mouth, because that's his genes telling him to do it. And then we have the hunting dogs. And regardless of what kind of hunting we're talking about, you know, the pointers are going to point, and the beagles are going to sniff and bay. You're not going to see a beagle stop and go, hey. That's not in his genetic code. And so we have created these dogs. And so their genetics, you know, dictates their behavior, a lot of their behavior. Then we have the environmental influences to behavior. And believe it or not, the environmental influences to behavior starts very early. It actually starts in utero. So when the puppies are in the oven, right, if mom has a traumatic event, that's going to affect the behavior of the puppies when they're born and grow up. Because when a pregnant mom has a traumatic event, the stress hormones that flow through her body go right into her puppies. And her puppies are bathed with stress hormones, and that's going to affect who they become. So puppies whose mom had trauma are going to be more sensitive, more emotional, okay? That's who they are. And so there's not much we can do about that except try really hard not to let pregnant moms have a traumatic event. Now, in the New England, where we're bringing up all these transport dogs, sometimes it gets really problematic because we do bring up pregnant moms. And so, you know, the whole thing is a little bit controversial. But this is one of the problems with that. And then we have the puppies that get born, and now how they're reared is going to affect their behavior. If they have a nice, nurturing mom who cares about them and, you know, builds their self-confidence and teaches them everything they're supposed to learn, that they're going to be more secure adults. But if mom doesn't know what she's doing, if mom doesn't even like her puppies, if she's afraid of her puppies, if she attacks her puppies, that's going to affect the puppies. The other thing is, if the puppies don't stay with their mom long enough, that's also going to affect their behavior. We want the puppies to stay with their mom at least 7 weeks, preferably 8 weeks, because mom teaches them really important things, in particular how to temper their aggression and also bite inhibition. But the other thing is the natural weaning process teaches the puppies impulse control, frustration tolerance, right? Frustration tolerance is, I want a drink, no. Mom says no, get away from me. And the puppies learn to deal with their frustration. Puppies that are hand raised can't deal with their frustration. So what happens during rearing affects their behavior. And then what happens during their critical period for socialization? The critical period for socialization in dogs is 3 to 12 weeks. This is a window when their brain is open to learning about what to expect in their life. Right? It's a very critical window. That's why when we get a puppy, we want to expose them to as many different things as we can. Different people, different experiences, sounds, textures, all kinds of stuff. Because what they learn now will give them security later on. Because if a puppy's not socialized during this period, they can be afraid of anything that they weren't socialized to as a puppy. Okay? And so that's why we call it the critical period for socialization. Now, the problem with that period is that if the puppy has a traumatic event during that critical period when their brain is open to learning about what to expect in this world, that's going to affect them forever. So let's say, for example, you're going to expose your little puppy to children because it's really important to socialize them to children. But a little three-year-old picks up the puppy, squeezes him really hard because he loves him so much, and then drops him on his head. And what that puppy's going to imprint now during this window is that little kids are dangerous. Okay, so you got to be careful that they don't have a trauma during this window. So basically everything an animal experiences in its life, whether it's good or bad, is going to affect their behavior. And then we have the influence of learning. And dogs are learning all the time. Dogs learn that when they perform a behavior, they learn whether or not that behavior is worth doing again. Okay? And we say that dogs do what works for them. Does this work for this dog?
Yeah.
Yeah, what does he get? He licked the butter dish, he got some crumbs from the toast, he got to look out at the squirrels, he got to lay in the sun. Does this work for you? No. Does he care? No. Not to come home and say, get off the table! Okay? So basically, nature plus nurture is what gives us behavior. And so they're all involved, and it's all really super important. The other thing you need to learn about dogs is that they live in a different sensory world than we do. And what dogs take in through their senses is going to also affect their behavior. And so this is something that everyone needs to learn, because we only think of how we take in the world through our senses, but they're quite different. So dogs have better hearing than we do. So a human can hear up to 20 kilohertz, but a dog can hear up to 60 kilohertz. You don't have to know what a kilohertz is to know they hear things we can't hear, right? They hear in the ultrasonic range. So they're always hearing things, and they could respond to those things. So if everything's quiet, you're reading your book, and all of a sudden the dog's like, right, going crazy. And you didn't hear anything. They can hear way better than us. If you've ever experienced this, where your dog is like staring at the wall. What's wrong with my dog? Right? There's probably a little rodent nest behind there. And they hear the little ultrasonic noises of the baby rodents calling their mom. And so they are hearing things we can't hear all the time. And they see differently than we do, which is also really interesting. If we look at the difference between a human's eye, sight, and a dog. So let's start with the human. The dark wedge is our binocular vision. So binocular vision is when both eyes are working to form one image. So we have a lot of binocular vision. We do not have a lot of peripheral vision. That's looking at, seeing out of the corner of our eye. Compare that to a dog. This is a dog's binocular vision, this little teeny triangle here. But look at their peripheral vision. So they see way better out here. Now, why is this the case? Because of this thing. Their schnoz, all right? They got this big, long nose, which is impeding their vision, at least from our standards. The difference might be like the pugs, right? The smushy-faced dogs are gonna have vision closer to ours, but most dogs with a big, long nose have this kind of vision. And so they have poor binocular vision, but better peripheral vision, and because of that, they have poor depth perception. So I can look at this room and tell that this row is in front of that row, is in front of that row. I can see the depth in the room. But a dog sitting here would just see a mass of people. They really couldn't tell the depth of the room. They also don't have real good close-up vision. If you've ever thrown a treat on the floor and your dog is like looking for it and you're thinking, it's right there. Right? It's because they're looking for it with their nose. They're not looking for it with their eyes. If they're looking for it with their eyes, they go like this. Okay? And I'll tell you in a second why they don't necessarily find it right away, although they always find it. And dogs have better distance at vision at a distance, so they can see better. If you ever see your dog look out the window and going like this? And you look out there and you see nothing, they probably see a squirrel down there. So they have better distance vision than we do. And we know that dogs have way better sense of smell than we do. Okay? Humans have 6 million scent receptors. Now that sounds like a lot until you compare it to a dog. Right? A dog has over 250 million scent receptors. And so the sense of smell, olfaction, is their number one sense. What's our number one sense? Vision. So we are vision, hearing, smell. A dog is smell, hearing, vision in terms of importance. Right? This is their number one sense. And so their olfactory bulb is 3 times larger than ours, even though their brains are 10 times smaller. Their olfactory system is huge compared to humans. The other interesting thing about dogs is that we have what we call scent habituation. You ever walk into a room and you go, ew, it stinks in here. And then within 5 minutes, you don't smell it anymore? Yeah. It's not because the smell dissipated, it's because you've habituated to the smell. The reason humans habituate to smell so quickly, besides the fact that our sense of smell is so crappy, is because we take in and blow out of the same 2 holes. Take in, blow out. So we habituate to the smell very, very quickly. What dogs do, they take in through the front, so they inhale through the front holes, exhale through the side holes. So let's go back here. Inhale through there, exhale through there. So the smell's never passing the same cells twice, so it doesn't habituate to it, which is really cool, okay? But this is why we are able to use dogs for search and rescue. It's why we use dogs for drug detection at the airport. And it's why nowadays we use dogs for all kinds of medical alert stuff. Diabetic alert dogs are smelling the blood sugar changes in your body. Seizure alert dogs are smelling the chemical changes in your brain right before you have a seizure. And this dog is being trained to sniff out cancer cells. We know the first cancer sniffing dog found skin cancer. We've been using dogs for skin cancer detection for a long time. Now they're finding that dogs can detect cancer cells in your internal organs. Their sense of smell goes way beyond anything we can even fathom, right? They also use them to detect bed bugs in hotels. They bring dogs in to see if there's a developing problem before there's so many bed bugs you have to throw away the mattress, right? Or the people start complaining. It's a little gross, but thank goodness for dogs. Dogs also have a specialized organ called the vomeral nasal organ. Now, the vomeral nasal organ sits above the roof of the mouth. all mammals have a vomeral nasal organ except humans. We have lost it through evolution because we don't use it. The purpose of a vomeral nasal organ is to take in and analyze pheromones. What pheromones are chemical messages emitted out of specialized glands in the body. And they're species specific, so dogs emit dog pheromones that only dogs detect. Cats emit cat pheromones that only cats detect. And the way they detect these pheromones, or the way they take them in anyway, once they detect a pheromone, dogs do a behavior we call tonguing. They take their tongue, the opening to the vomeral nasal organ is right behind the incisor teeth. So they, when they're sniffing something, they're going, you don't even notice it, but they're pushing the pheromone up into that vomeral nasal organ. And they want to analyze it. So whenever they're sniffing the body of another dog, or urine or feces of another dog, or where it was left on the ground, they are not only smelling, they are detecting pheromones. So it's really interesting. But this is why, when your dog spends 20 minutes sniffing the same damn blade of grass, it's because it's that interesting to them. We're like, come on! We do so much patience with our dogs when they want to sniff. So the analogy I like to make, because vision is our number one sight sense, let's think about, I want to watch the sunset today. So you get your lawn chair out, you get a glass of wine, and you're like, okay, I'm ready. So there's the sun, and then you sit there for 20 minutes, or however long it takes for it to go down, and the sky to change every second as the sun is going down, and you take it in, and you know, the whole 20 minutes you're enjoying it. That's what's happening here. For 20 minutes, they can be getting something out of that smell. Right? And so just try to remember that and let them sniff. Right? Let your dogs sniff their world. It's so frustrating when we yank them away from every smell. So the analogy I like to make again, let's say you've always wanted to go to the Grand Canyon your whole life. You finally get to go to the Grand Canyon, and right before you get to the edge, someone throws a blindfold on you. And you can't see it. Right? All you ever wanted to do was see the Grand Canyon, right? So we're basically throwing a blindfold on them every time we yank them away from something they want to smell. Now, there's a limit. We got to get to work. I'm not saying, you know, be out there for 3 hours letting your dog sniff. But do think about the fact that they really like to sniff. I like to think about it as them reading their newspaper, right? So you go home at night, you get the paper, you read it, find out what's going on in the world. Your dog is reading their newspaper when they're sniffing the neighborhood. All right. Lots of behaviors that dogs do that you have a problem with are just normal dog behaviors, right? The things that dogs like to do, they bark, they dig, they chew, they chase things, they're territorial, they roll in stinky stuff, and they eat poop. Why do they do these things? Because they're dogs, and all of this stuff comes naturally to them, right? Let's talk about barking to start. Barking is a normal dog behavior. It's one way dogs communicate with us, with other dogs, with the world. And there's lots of reasons why dogs bark. There's lots of messaging in there. All right? They can bark to get your attention. They can bark when they're bored. They can bark when they're lonely. They can bark when they're frustrated, when they're excited. What social facilitation is when another dog barks. They bark. It's like, you know, how many of you have multiple dogs? All right? One dog is like, and the other dog are like, what are we barking at? They don't care if they know what they're barking at. They just bark because of social facilitation. Okay. And they end up bark when they're responding to any kind of stimuli that they feel alerted to. So they can bark. So there's lots of reasons why dogs bark. Digging is normal dog behavior, and dogs dig for lots of reasons. For some dogs, it's an innate behavior. So terriers, of course, are genetically programmed to dig. They're looking for the rodents. They dig because they're bored. They dig because they're hot. They're trying to get a cool place to lay. They dig to try to escape the yard. They dig to bury things because they love to bury things and save them for later. You know, they hardly ever find them. You find that old, nasty, like, marrow bone that you gave them 3 weeks ago. But digging is just fun. It's a behavior that dogs really dig. Just see if you guys are awake. All right, chewing is normal dog behavior. Dogs have a need to chew. They chew when they're bored, they chew when they're stressed. They also chew just for fun. They like to chew. Chasing things is a normal dog behavior. Everybody see the squirrel? So dogs are the descendants of wolves, and of course wolves are predators. Are dogs predators? No. If they were predators, they wouldn't be living in your home and sharing your bed. We have domesticated the dog so they're not predators anymore. Are cats predators?
Yes. Yes.
Luckily they can't kill us. But dogs still retain predatory instincts. Okay, so most dogs will still chase a squirrel, a bunny, you know, a chipmunk, a cat. They'll chase things. A lot of times they tree them, and the squirrel always gets the best of them, right? That's about it. Every once in a while you'll have a dog who actually catches something, and then they're like, oh my god, what do I do with it? Okay, chasing things is normal dog behavior. Territorial behavior is normal dog behavior. This is actually one of the reasons we domesticated the dog. We wanted them to guard our territory. And so, yes, we created the guarding breed, but it doesn't have to be a guarding breed to feel territorial. Most dogs have a sense of territory and will bark at people that are entering that territory. Even if, you know, once they get in the house, they're licking them to death, right? They like them, but they're still like, woo, someone's here, someone's here, someone's here, right? They still got to let you know. Rolling in stinky stuff is actually normal dog behavior. Anyone know why they roll in stinky stuff? Well, there's two theories of why they roll in stinky stuff, and they're probably both true, depending on the dog and the motivation at the moment. First one is, they just like the smell, right? They have a different sense than we do. You put that perfume on and they're like, ugh, nasty. They like the smell of a dead animal. The other theory is, it covers their scent, that it's an ancestral behavior, because wolves will often roll in stinky stuff before they go for a hunt to cover their own scent. And so your dog is probably doing this behavior for both of those reasons. Eating poop is normal dog behavior, believe it or not. Okay? This I call the doggy, the kitty cafe. So the kitty cafe serves on a daily basis tuna flavored Tootsie Rolls. Why would you go to the cafe? It's free, right? And why do people care? Because now you don't have to clean it up. People care. But why do they do this? First of all, dogs are scavengers, right? The scavenging nature of a wolf is how we got dogs. So we go way back in time when there were just wolves and, you know, our ancestor people. And the wolves were hunters and scavengers because they'll always pick something dead and eat it, right? Well, then the humans started forming villages and they had dumps where all their waste was. And some wolves are like, I don't feel like hunting today. I think I'm gonna go over there because there's scraps. And they go to the dump and they start scavenging in the dump. The other wolves are like, yeah, they're too close to those weird two-legged people. I'm gonna keep hunting. So the wolves that started scavenging in the dumps started realizing, hey, this is a pretty cool life. Those people aren't hurting me and I get free food. And those wolves started breeding and their offspring started getting more and more accustomed to being close to humans. And pretty soon, over time, there's a whole different line of wolves that were living close to humans. And those were the ones we were able to take and then domesticate and turn into what we have now. There's still the other whole line that said, we're not going near those things. And they're now still wolves, okay? But it was the scavenging nature of the wolf that gave us the dog in the first place. Dogs are still scavengers, right? And feces contains undigested food. So to a dog, that tuna-flavored Tootsie Roll isn't poop, it's food. The other thing is that dogs will also learn to eat poop from their mom. So a mom dog cleans up the nest by eating the poop. It's pretty gross, and thank goodness we don't have to do it, right? And so the puppies in this time see mom eating it, smell it on her breath, imprint that it's food. So most young dogs will eat poop. A lot of them outgrow it, But there are still some dogs that continue throughout their lives to eat poop. Who's got a poop eater? All right. In fact, that scavenging nature leads to other behavior problems we don't like garbage raiding, that's scavenging, and counter surfing, that's scavenging. So remember, your dog is a scavenger, and if he has an opportunity to get food, he's gonna get food. We get so mad, we're like, I spent all this money on the top quality dog food, you get two meals a day, plus cookies, and you still get into the trash. Because he's a scavenger. He's just doing what comes naturally to him. Now, in addition to the fact that dogs do doggy things that annoy us, we often expect way too much from our dogs. Right? Number one, we expect them to share our value system. Okay? But they don't. A dog has no idea about monetary value, right? Your shoe has no more value to that dog, in fact, it probably has a different value to that dog, because it smells like you, than the toy you gave them. They don't know the difference. They are looking to chew on something novel, something interesting, usually it's scent related. Your shoe smells like you, and it smells like everywhere you've been. And what a cool thing to chew on. So no value system. We expect dogs to understand English, but they don't, okay? So this is my favorite Gary Larson cartoon. Right, so we have, okay, Ginger, I've had it. Stay out of the garbage. Understand, Ginger? Stay out of the garbage or else. What is Ginger here?
Blah, blah, blah,
blah, blah, blah, blah. Now, dogs don't understand our language, but they learn words. The words are sounds associated with things. The average dog learns about 200 words in its lifetime. Right? So it's pretty good vocabulary for something that, you know, doesn't speak English. They learn these words. Sit does, you know, it doesn't have that same meaning as us, but they've learned sit means plant your butt. And down means lie down, and come means come to my person. But you could tell them, tuna fish, and they would sit. If you taught them sit, the action of sitting is called tuna fish. That's what they would do when you said tuna fish. Like, it's not the word itself, the meaning of the word that we have, it's what they're associating it with, because dogs learn through association, right? The smartest dog on record is a border collie that's learned, I think, probably now 4,000 words, maybe more, that they've been working with over the years. So they'll have a room full of as many toys as there are people in here, and they'll say, go get your green dinosaur. Now, not only is the green dinosaur among all a bunch of other toys, but there's also a red dinosaur, a blue dinosaur, and the dog goes and gets the green dinosaur. Like, this dog can identify tons of words, which is really cool, and it's a cool article to read about this dog. Okay. We expect them to know, or at least learn, right from wrong. So what you need to do to know and understand is that they don't. Okay? Dogs do not have morals. Morals are, it's a higher thinking process that is only humans have. Right? Morals are tied into human brains. Dogs don't have morals. And without morals, they don't learn right from wrong. But what they do learn is safe from unsafe. And that's really different. They learn it is unsafe to lay on the couch when you're home. Perfectly safe when you want. Okay? And so this gets dogs into a lot of trouble because you come home and you're pissed off that they did something you thought you had taught them was wrong. But no, you didn't teach them it was wrong. You just taught them it's not safe to do it when I am home. Okay? We also expect them to be able to connect the punishment with the crime even after the fact. But they don't, okay? If you don't punish a behavior while it's happening, or within a half a second, which is a really short amount of time, the dog has absolutely no idea why they're being punished. So now let's tie the last thing I said with this thing. So your dog doesn't learn it's wrong to get into the trash. He learns it's not safe to do it when you're home. It's perfectly safe and very, very rewarding when you're not home, because I get to eat all the garbage in there. You come home 5 hours after he's gotten into the trash, and you yell at the dog. And the dog acts like this. And you think he feels guilty. I'm going to tell you later, I'm going to go back to that part later in terms of his body language, but just right now I want to talk about what this dog thinks. That dog thinks, man, you are really schizo. Sometimes you come home and you're yelling at me, and I just don't know, I don't understand you. You're really unpredictable. Right? The dog isn't saying, oh, sorry, I got into the trash. There's absolutely no idea your punishment has anything to do with the trash. Okay? And I'm going to talk about body language in a minute. We expect them to interpret things the way we mean them. The best example is this. We hug our dogs all the time. But hugging is a primate behavior. We have arms. We hug to show affection. Dogs do not like to be hugged. This is something you're going to go away with being very sad. To a dog, hugging is not affection, it is restraint. Now, your dog will tolerate your restraint when they're bonded to you. They're like, hurry up. They learn that we must do this, and humans must hug. They don't like it, they tolerate it. And when I start talking about body language, I want you to then go home. One of you hug the dog, the other one look at the dog. And you'll see the signals I'm going to talk about later. But they don't like hugging. But we think we're showing them affection, all right? So we expect them to interpret things the way we mean them, but they don't, okay? And it's really, really important that you understand what kinds of things upset your dog. Because this is what gets us into trouble. The difference between humans' behavior and all the things that we believe and dogs that are a totally different species. Just because that we've domesticated and they live in our home doesn't mean that we understand each other. All right? Because we know that dogs can sometimes bite. And so why do dogs sometimes bite? Well, because they're dogs, and biting is a behavioral option that all dogs have. And when they feel threatened, they sometimes feel like they have to protect themselves. Now, there's other reasons why dogs bite, in terms of, you know, being territorial or all that kind of stuff, but it's often about being threatened in some way. Right? And so biting is a behavioral option that every single dog is capable of. Now, some dogs go through their entire life without biting anybody. But a lot of dogs end up biting somebody. Right? And so what we need to understand is that emotions can drive behavior. And so this is especially true with the behavior of biting. So my question to you is, what is the most common emotion that causes dogs to bite?
Fear.
Fear.
Fear. Okay? So oftentimes we do something to or around a dog that is fear-provoking and causes the dog to bite. How many of you have ever heard flight or fight? You hear flight or fight. Animals trigger to fight or flight when they're feeling threatened. And if you think about it, which most people don't really think about it too much, flight means I'm going to try to get away from this sort of thing. Fight means, oh my God, I can't get away. I'm going to have to try to make this thing get away from me. So the fight response is aggressive behavior to try to get you to get away. And if you don't get away, sometimes they feel forced to bite. And so we have to understand that sometimes we provoke fear in dogs. Right? Now, there's usually a good reason for dogs to bite. At least the dog thinks so. Right? So I hear this all the time. The bite was unprovoked. And I say, as a behaviorist, there is absolutely no such thing as an unprovoked bite unless that dog has a brain tumor or is dying of rabies. Okay? So most of the time, there is provocation to the dog, even if you human can't see it. right? So why do dogs bite? The person or child has done something to frighten or startle the dog. And I separate person and child, not because I personally think they're two totally different beings, but that's supposed to be a joke. But because, you know, kids are the number one bite victims. And so, I mean, adults get bitten too, but kids get bitten a lot. So the person or child does something to frighten or startle the dog, that can trigger the biting. Or the person or child actually hurts the dog, right? So physical punishment oftentimes makes dogs trigger to defensive aggression. There is no place for physical punishment with our companion animals. It is just not the right thing to do. It doesn't correct behavior, it makes behavior worse, and it can trigger aggressive behavior. Sometimes dogs bite when they're protecting a possession, right? This is called resource guarding behavior. And resource guarding behavior, again, stems from the fact that dogs are the descendants of wolves. And wolves, as social predators, are resource guarders. They go out as a pack, they take down a big old animal, they all pull off their piece, and then they covet it so they can survive. Okay. So we've tried to get resource guarding out of the domesticated dog because we don't like it and it can be dangerous, but a certain percentage of dogs still retain this ancestral trait of resource guarding. They'll guard their food, they'll guard their toys, they'll guard their bed, they'll guard anything, a tissue they stole, which they can do. So sometimes it's about resource guarding, but again, it's about being threatened. If you're a resource guarder and you have something and here comes somebody that might take it away, you feel threatened. Sometimes they bite, again, protecting their property because dogs are naturally territorial. So again, you don't have to be a guard dog to bite someone who's entering your territory. So these are some of the other reasons that dogs bite. Sometimes they bite when they're old, grumpy, in pain, or just having a bad day. You know, old dogs oftentimes can't tolerate children, they're arthritic, they're tired, they don't want to deal with kids. So old dogs oftentimes will bite kids that are bugging them. But a lot of times it's about, you know, a kid falls on the dog bites the kid, it's a pain-induced bite. But we got to be careful when we have kids around older dogs. All right, so we need to learn to read dog emotions. Right? You have to know when your dog is not feeling so cool because that's going to help you help your dog. Now, dogs use their bodies to communicate. They use their bodies to communicate with each other, and they use their bodies to try to communicate with us. Right? They don't have a verbal language. Again, they learn those 200 words, but they can't spit them back out at us. Right? They are trying to tell us how they feel using the only language they know, and that is the language of body language. So the interesting thing about dogs is that they are better at reading our body language than we are at reading theirs. So when we domesticated the dog is what we call a social obligate species. A social obligate species is a species that must have social companionship to be emotionally healthy in their life. We humans are a social obligate species also. So when we domesticated the dog and brought him into our homes and our families, we became their social group. All right, how many of you only have one dog? Right? That one dog is not pining for other dogs. They're totally fine just living with humans. Dogs are fine just living with humans. Okay? But because of who they are, because they read body language, they've learned to read our body language. So they know what we're about ready to do a lot of times just because they're watching us so closely. And so there's research that shows that a dog reads human body language better than a chimpanzee, which shares 98% of our genetic material. So one experiment is the motion of pointing. Dogs get it right almost every time. A chimp is like, well, I don't know, guesses. Gets it right maybe 50% of the time. Our closest relatives have absolutely no idea. Why? They don't live with humans. It's not a gesture they use. But dogs live with humans. The problem is they've done a better job of reading our body language than we have to educate ourselves to read theirs. And that oftentimes gets them into trouble, it gets you into trouble, because you don't know your dog is not feeling so cool. So being able to read body language will allow you to know how the dog is feeling at any given moment. It'll guide how you act around that dog, and it'll also help you keep yourself and your children safe. So I told you that kids are the number one bite victims. We want to keep our children safe from dog bites. The only way to do that is to teach them to be able to read body language, but also to not threaten dogs into a position where they feel like they have to bite. How to be safe around dogs. So I want to talk a little bit about reading body language, right? And hoping that you're going to learn a lot, and you're going to go and you're going to look at your dog differently, and you're going to see things you never saw before, and it's going to be really, really cool. It's like taking, you know, 10 lessons in Spanish and actually talking to the first Spanish person and being able to say a few words of understanding, okay? It'll be really neat. So, I'm going to start by showing you the black and white things that I'm going to show through this part are from a book by Dr. Stanley Korn. He's a PhD dog researcher. He's a really interesting guy. He's written several books that I really like. How to Speak Dog is where these pictures come from. He also writes a blog, if you're taking notes. He writes a blog on Psychology Today. That's the website. Go to Psychology Today, plug in Stanley Korn. And his blog is always really interesting. And you can go back and read previous blogs too. But this dog is a dog who's relaxed. And so what we see in this dog's body language is that he has no muscle tension in his body. He's just kind of hanging out there. He's got even weight distribution on all four paws. His tail's just hanging out loosely. And if we look at his face is what we call an open, relaxed face. It just means that there's no muscle tension. Just hanging out, right? These dogs are in that kind of position. They're just calm, relaxed dogs. And calm, relaxed. Just nice, no muscle tension, just hanging out. This position is what we call the play bow. The play bow is a signal that dogs give two times. One, they give it when they're trying to initiate play. And two, they give it during play with another dog to signal that what they're about ready to do is still play. Because if they didn't signal this first, when they grab him by his neck and take him down, right, the other dog might think he's being attacked. But when they play bow first and then do it, the other dog knows they're still playing. So what we see is back end up, front end down, nice, wide open, happy face. They're having a good time. They're playing. They want to play. They're having a good time. So this is what we call a play bow. And we love it because it's cute. And dogs, of course, have learned to give the signal to us because this is one signal we most humans know. That means they want to play. Now, this is a signal that you oftentimes will miss or misinterpret, which is why I want to spend a little bit of time on this one. This is what we call passive appeasement behavior. Passive appeasement are signals that dogs display when they're feeling threatened or overwhelmed by a social encounter. It can be with a human or another dog. And so what we see in this dog is he's flopped over on his back, exposed his belly. But let's look deeper. His tail is tucked, his little wrists are bent, his ears are back, his mouth is closed with the corners of his mouth pulled back. And you might even see a little dribble of urine. This is a dog who's feeling really overwhelmed and threatened, right? Now, most people will say this is a submissive dog, right? The problem with the word submissive is a human's interpretation of it. We think that when a dog is submitting to us, they're saying, you are the boss, you can do whatever you want to me. That could not be further from the truth when a dog does this. When a dog shows these signals, belly exposed, tucked tail, folded wrist, ears back, closed mouth, and you also see little huge dilated pupils, which I'm going to talk about in a second. All right, that tells you that dog is nervous about something that you're doing. And so when you think, oh, he's being submissive, and you go over and rub his belly, that's not what he was asking you to do. He's asking you to back off and kind of be less threatening. Okay. So you need to learn these signals. Now, I'm not saying there aren't dogs that like a belly rub. Of course there are, but they look totally different. So you see the difference?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this guy is like, yeah, give me a belly rub. I love it. And this guy is saying, oh my God, you're really scaring me. Please back off. All right? So please do learn this. Now, dogs with a submissive personality are dogs that are more likely to get overwhelmed by social interactions. So submissive personality dogs might be more likely to show appeasement signals, but they're not saying, I submit to you, you can do whatever you want me to do. Okay? All right, so I want you to be able to recognize it. Tucked tail, exposed body, bent wrist, ears back, closed mouth. See at the end when he sticks out his tongue? I'm going to talk about that in a second, too. All right, so now this is a dog who's also showing appeasement signals. So he's also feeling overwhelmed or threatened with the social encounter, but he's not flopped over on his back. So what we see in this guy is his body posture is lowered, his tail is down, his ears are back, his mouth is closed with those corners pulled back, he's got his little tongue flicks out, and you see this oftentimes, this classic paw raise. Okay, it's not a dog who wants you to shake. And sometimes, depending on the floor surface, you might see sweaty footprints. Because the only place dogs sweat is through their foot pads. So when a dog is nervous, they're going to sweat just like we do. But that's the only place they sweat. And so they might leave sweaty footprints. So this dog is saying, also, you are really stressing me out here. So we got lower body posture. His head is lower than his back. We got that classic paw raise. We got that closed mouth. Right? He looks worried. This dog is showing appeasement signals. Right? And so feeling very, very threatened. Of course, this dog is also trembling, but we're looking at the appeasement signals. Now, this dog is really afraid. So this dog is in that flight or fight mode, and because he's afraid, he's showing mixed signals, mixed between those appeasement signals I just talked about and aggression signals to try to scare you away. And so what we see is that lowered body posture, tucked tail. We see his hackles are up. So hackles is the term we give when their hair stands up, okay? So the hackles are up, we see his ears are back, and we see the corners of his mouth have pulled back, but now he's showing his teeth, so he's snarling, and he's probably growling, too. So this dog is feeling very threatened, very afraid, and what he's saying is, oh my God, you're really scaring me, please back away from me. Please, please, please get away from me. He's trying to make you get away because he can't get away himself. So this is what we call fear aggression or defensive aggression. Because defensive, fearful dogs are going to be defensive, trying to protect themselves. Right? So one way to remember the difference between defensive and offensive, which I'll go over next, is that with defensive dogs, everything goes back. Their ears go back, their body weight goes back, even the corners of their mouth go back, as opposed to some of the other times. So we see this dog, he's backing up, see his tail tucked, he's barking, he's trying to get that person to back off. Okay? So fear behavior. As opposed to offensive aggressive dogs. Offensively aggressive dogs are going to look totally different, and the motivation for their aggressive behavior is totally different. So where the last guy was saying, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, you're scaring me, please back off. This guy's saying, yeah, make my day, right? Okay, he's locked and loaded and ready to say his piece. So what we see, the difference in him, he's standing really tall. He's got more weight in the on the front. His body is stiff. His tail is what we call flagged, and he's all puffed out and pilo erect. And if we look at his face, his ears are facing forward, and the corners of his mouth have now come forward. And he's just showing you his front teeth. So this is a dog who's being offensive. He's coming forward. So defensive, everything goes back. Offensive, everything goes forward. Make sense? Right? All right, so now, let's look at individual body parts and talk a little bit about that. All right? The ears of a scared dog are gonna be flattened back. And certainly, again, dogs, when they're feeling appeasing, and they will flatten their ears back too. But we know a dog who flattens his ears back is feeling uncomfortable. The ears of an alert or an angry dog are going to be held up high and facing forward. Right? Now, this is only true, of course, of the dogs that have those big, what we call pricked ear dogs, this, or ears, the ones that stand up. Because some breeds of dogs have these big floppy ears. And when they have big pendulous floppy ears, they can't use their ears as well as other dogs to show their emotions. Right? So again, we've created this breed of dog and those ears to serve a purpose. What's the purpose of a basset hound's big floppy ears? Anyone know? Scent. As they run, they flap, and the scent goes right up into their nose, right? So it is, again, a creation of ours to serve a purpose. But it takes away their ability to speak with their ears. Let's look at their tail for a second, right? So when a tail goes from a low neutral position to up higher, in particular this flag tail, that is a dog who's getting more and more and more alert, aroused, or angry. Okay, so we see this high flag tail. And then dogs that are fearful, the tail's gonna start going under. Tuck, 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 tuck. And so you can see their tail and you can tell how they're feeling based on their tail sometimes. The tails of an alert or angry dog are often held up really high, flag tail. But the tails of a frightened dog are often gonna be tucked between the dog's legs. Now, some breeds of dogs, of course, have these little corkscrew curly tails, which means that we can't tell as well how they're feeling based only on their tail. This is why we gotta look at everything else, because for those dogs, their tail isn't gonna flag, and it's gonna be harder to tuck. They can tuck them, but it's gonna be harder. So some dogs have those tails. And a warning, right? A wagging tail does not always mean a friendly dog. Many a person has been bitten by a dog who's wagging his tail. And so they say, well, he was kind of looking mean at me, but he was wagging his tail, so I thought it was okay to go see him. And they learned very quickly that wagging tail did not give them the correct information. So you have to understand that wagging tail doesn't mean a friendly dog. Now there's different kinds of wags. So generally speaking, if the tail is below the horizon of the back and wagging, it is usually friendly. There's always exceptions to every rule. But if the tail is at or above the horizon of the back and wagging, all it tells you is the dog is aroused, is excited. And that can be a bad arousal or good arousal. It's hard to tell, which is why you gotta look at everything else about the dog and look at the situation. But if you see this high flag, stiff tail, you're not gonna go near that dog, because that's telling you, oh, this guy's a little bit, potentially angry. That high flag, stiff tail is usually a signal of aggression. So be careful with that tail. All right, so let's look really specifically at their faces and their mouths. So again, the happy, relaxed face is when we don't see any muscle tension in their face. Everything's just hanging loose, right? Their jaw's loose, everything's loose. And, it looks like a happy dog, yes? The worry dogs are going to have a worry tennis face. Now, I didn't have to look this up there, because if I had said, what do you think these dogs are feeling? You could have said, really, what kind of worry? They look worried because their mouths are closed and tense. All right, they have muscle tension around their eyes, their brow is furrowed. They just look worried. Now, the interesting thing about dogs is they're very, very expressive. Their facial expressions are really similar to humans. And so humans can read their facial expressions pretty well if you pay attention, right? Because it's so much like ours. Unlike a cat, I love cats, by the way, but cats are pretty, you know, neutral. Like, unless they're going, their face, unless they're actually hissing at you or growling at you, doesn't give away their emotions, right? But a dog wears their emotions on their sleeve and in their face, for sure. And so you can tell that these dogs are feeling a little bit worried, right? And what we can also really, what you need to understand is dogs can go from feeling okay one moment to not feeling okay the next. And you got to look at these subtle little things that they do. Like, here's an open, relaxed face, no muscle tension, and then all of a sudden the mouth closes. That says something just happened to change the way the dog feels. We have a good moment, bad moment. And again, this is important for you to see, because nobody really notices this. Unless you learn it, you don't notice it. So look how that dog's face changed, right? So he's all happy, everything's relaxed, the muscles are loose. But as soon as those kids crowd him, which dogs do not like, and really, do we like it? No. We've got our bubble. No, we only let certain people in our bubble. But that dog changed. His mouth closed, and everything got a little tense, right? So dogs can go from good moment to bad moment really quickly. Now, the obvious warning signs of aggression. I don't need to teach you, because if you can't recognize these things, we're in trouble, right? Or you're in trouble, I should say.
Dogs in trouble,
right? Snarling is showing teeth. Growling, obviously, is a warning signal. Back off. Lunging and snapping are, you know, stepping it up a notch. That you need to back off me. All right. So you guys understand those. But what I want to teach you today are the more subtle signs that dogs give that they're feeling uncomfortable. Let's start with their eyes, right? Direct eye contact in dog language is a threat or a challenge. Now, with our pet dogs, we teach them, watch me, right? It's the first thing I teach in a basic class. I want my dog to feel comfortable looking up into my eyes, because we humans give eye contact all the time. It's how we interact with each other, and it's how we do with our dogs. So we gotta socialize our dogs and teach them eye contact from a human is not bad. But when a dog that you don't know gives you direct eye contact and he doesn't look so happy, that is a threat or a challenge. When their pupils dilate, so we know our pupils dilate with light changes. That's how it works, right? So if we turn off the lights right now, your pupils would dilate, get bigger, and so more light could come in. And if we then threw the lights back on, they would constrict, because we don't need the light anymore. That's true of dogs' pupils too. However, their pupils also dilate because of strong emotions. The strong emotions of fear and anger can cause their pupils to dilate. It's a physiological response. It's not something they consciously do. But when you see a pupil dilate, but the light has not changed, you know that something inside the dog has changed. So people often don't really recognize it's the pupil dilating, but I hear this all the time. His eye got glazed over, or he got that funny look in his eye. Usually it's because when the pupil dilates, light reflects differently on the pupil than it does the iris. And so that's why it kind of looks funny. And then there's this weird thing we call the whale eye. The weird part is what we call it. where the dog shows the whites of his eye, because typically we don't see the whites of a dog's eye like humans, right? We can see a lot of our sclera, but not a dog. But when you see the whites of their eye, that often tells you the dog is uncomfortable, okay? And so there's two times a dog will show the whites of their eye. One is when they turn their head to try to avoid you, but they're too afraid of you to take their eyes off of you. So they turn their head, but they don't move their eye. Head moves, eye doesn't. The other time is when their head stays still, but their eye moves. So this guy's head stayed still, but he moved his eye up to look at you. All right, so like think about a dog who likes to guard his food. He's eating his food, and he sees you coming. And he doesn't want to take his mouth out of the bowl, but his eye goes to look at you. Those are the times we see whale eye, where we see the whites of the eye, okay? And it's a signal that means that something's going on. The dog doesn't really feel that comfortable. Now, when you see the whites all the way around the iris, that is profound fear, unless you have a pug whose eyeballs stick out of his head naturally. Okay, some breeds of dogs that, you know, don't like the pug. But if you see that, you know that dog is really, really freaked out. It's profound fear when you see the whites all the way around. Their mouth. If you see a dog with a closed, tense mouth, clenched jaw, muscle tension, that's a dog who is tense. Or if they go from an open, relaxed mouth to a closed, tense mouth. So, like the picture I just showed you. Now, a worried dog will have a closed, tense mouth with his eyebrows raised up. And an angry dog will have a closed, tense mouth with his eyebrows pointing down. And once again, you can look at those two pictures, and based on our knowledge of our own faces, you can tell that guy's worried, that guy looks a little PO'd, right? Their body, if the dog is stiff-bodied, it means that they're not completely comfortable. Or if they go from a loose body and stiffen, it means you better pay attention to what just happened, because that dog just changed. Something just changed. You're interacting with a dog, or see your child interacting with a dog. So if we look at this picture, this dog has a stiff body, a high flag tail, giving that little boy direct eye contact and barking at him. Is this little boy safe? Does the parent taking the picture know it? Probably not. Will you know it now next time? Better, okay? This child can't figure that out. It's up to parents to learn this stuff and teach their children, right? But it is important that we look at the whole dog and everything I just told you to kind of get a feel for what that dog is feeling at any given moment. Now, other ways that dogs communicate that they're uncomfortable, they show displacement behaviors. Displacement behaviors are stress signals. They're signals dogs give to mean I'm a little bit stressed. Now, displacement behaviors are things that happen naturally, but seem to be happening at a weird time. Flicking their tongue out. Now, we flick our tongue out when we want to wet our lips and stuff. But dogs flick their tongue out when they're feeling a little bit anxious. Right, so watch this video. See the tongue flick out? As he backed up, tongue flicked out. That tells you he's a little anxious. That is a displacement behavior. Yawning when not tired is a displacement behavior. Of course dogs yawn when they're tired, like we do. But when they yawn at a weird time, and you know they didn't just get up from a nap or something, it's a displacement. Yawn, lip lick. Okay, so you see that yawn and then that lip lick. Lip licking is the next one. Right, so we have tongue flick, yawning, lip licking. And now let's watch some of these videos. Look at all the lip licking. Yawn. Lip licking. So, I'm not saying that that dog is going to eat that baby. But what I can tell you is that dog is not completely comfortable when the baby hits him. He does it when the kid is like hitting him. Let's watch this guy. Lots of yawning, lip licking. So again, he is not comfortable with that hug because dogs don't like to be hugged. And this guy doesn't want this baby on. Lots of yawning and lip licking, and the parent has absolutely no clue. So again, these are signals you have to learn specifically because kids do things to dogs dogs don't really like. And then the dog is constantly saying, that really, I don't like it. And pretty soon, what's going to happen? When the dog feels like he's given enough warning, but the thing keeps happening, then they might have to escalate their behavior. All right, dogs also show avoidance behaviors. They turn their head away, they turn their whole body away, they move completely away, or they hide. Okay, so avoidance is one way that they can deal. So if you see a dog trying to get away from a kid, let the dog get away from the kid. Tell that kid to get over here. We must heed the warning signals. Once you learn the warning signals, you have to respect that communication in the dog, right? The displacement behaviors are telling you the dog is uncomfortable and telling you you need to adjust your behavior or you need to help your children adjust their behavior. When you see sniffing, growling, snarling, they're warning signals. Back off. And when you see snapping, snapping is what we call an inhibited bite. It's very, very meaningful and you have to take it seriously. People say, oh, he just snaps. He's never bitten. No, he's fine. It's a very serious behavior. Because once a dog bites, he's more likely to bite again. So we don't want to ever let our dog bite. All right, here's your quiz. I want you to call out things you see in this dog that tell you he's afraid.
His tongue.
Tail.
Good, so these guys are seeing it all now, right? We got a crouched body, a tucked tail, ears back, whale eye, closed tense mouth with a tongue flick. Did you guys get them all? Right? What about this guy? Right. Okay, so we got dilated pupils, whale eye, ears back, closed tense mouth. Are the kids having fun?
Yeah.
Is the dog having fun?
No.
Does the parent who's taking the picture know it?
No.
So if this dog someday bites this child, what they're going to say is, the dog's always been fine with the kids. I don't understand it. Well, no, he hasn't really been fine with the kids. We got to learn this stuff. Right? And never let your children do things to your dog because even though your dog might tolerate it because they have a bond with your child, if your child thinks it's okay to do it to their dog, they're gonna go to their friend's house and they're gonna do the same thing to their friend's dog, and their friend's dog is not bonded to your child, right? Really super important. I tell parents, don't let your kids hug your dog even if the dog would tolerate it, because that kid is gonna think they can hug any dog. So, some safe interactions with dogs. One, human behaviors elicit fear in dogs. Direct eye contact, if you don't know that dog and don't have a bond with that dog. Frontal body posture, we're very frontal beings. Leaning over the dog, reaching towards the dog, using a harsh voice, making fast jerky motions in their direction, and certainly physical punishment. All right, what do we do instead? Let the dog get used to our presence before we go over and start trying to interact. Hi, baby, hi. All right, move slowly and smoothly, not fast and jerky. Don't give them direct eye contact. Stand or squat a little sideways. So give them your side, that's less threatening. And talk in a calm, happy voice. Offer the back of your hand to sniff, but don't jam it into their face. Dogs learn about people by smell, their number one sense. Let them approach you, and only if they approach do you pet them under their chin or behind their ears, not over their head, because that's scary. And we got to teach our children how to greet dogs properly so that they also know not to get themselves into trouble. We got to teach children to stay away from loose dogs that they don't know. And we have to teach children to ask permission before they approach a dog that's with an owner. And not to rush up to the dog or reach quickly to the dog or certainly to hug the dog that they don't know. Okay? So how do you prevent your dog from biting? Number one, socialize well. And of course, puppyhood is when we really want to do a lot of socialization. Manage your dog well. You know, manage it with the leash and the fence and the baby gate and the crates. Train your dog. It's important that you train your dog. And it's also important that you recognize when your dog is uncomfortable. And the way you do that is to learn all this body language stuff. And you want to respect your dog's personal space. What I teach kids is that dogs have a bubble around them. And you're not supposed to go into their bubble, you know, unless you have a bond with that dog. Teach your kids to respect that dog. and supervise kids whenever they're around a dog. Right? Know your dog. Really look at your dog and learn his body language. Right? What does your dog look like when he's feeling relaxed and happy? Because your dog's tail and ears and everything are going to be, they're all different. And then learn when, what changes when they feel worried. Like really look at your dog and figure this stuff out based on everything you just learned. At any moment of the day, a dog is giving you a status update on how they feel. Every social interaction, they're letting you know how they feel. Pay attention to them. And don't allow your dog to be pushed to a bite. Because once they are pushed to a bite, everything changes. Everything changes in your life, everything changes for the dog. Right? So you need to help your dog if she needs help. You need to get them out of the jam before they make the wrong decision. Okay, so how do dogs learn? Is the next thing we're gonna talk about, which is really important. They basically learn two ways, right? The first way is what we call classical conditioning. And the second way is what we call operant conditioning. I'm going to tell you what these things mean. Classical conditioning is Pavlovian conditioning, okay? It's about learning associations. So Pavlov's dogs, everybody knows who Pavlov's dogs are, right? What Pavlov discovered was that when he rang the bell and gave food, rang the bell and gave food, rang the bell and gave food, and then when he rang the bell and there was no food around, what did the dogs do? Drooled. So, dogs will drool when they see food. They have absolutely no response to a bell, but when they connect the bell with the food, pretty soon the bell elicits the same behavior as the food itself. This is called Pavlovian conditioning, also called classical conditioning. And for simplicity, it's just about learning associations. This predicts this. And dogs are learning through Pavlovian conditioning all the time. This predicts this. This predicts this. They learn associations every single day. So they're always learning through Pavlovian conditioning. The other form of learning is called operant conditioning. And operant conditioning is learning through the consequence of your behavior. If the consequence of the behavior is rewarding to the dog, the behavior is going to happen again. Because if the behavior is reinforced, it'll happen again. If the behavior is not rewarding to the dog shouldn't repeat the behavior. So anything your dog is doing, he's getting some kind of reward for it. But sometimes we don't see the reward. When the dog barks at the mailman, what's the reward? The mailman leaves. So people say, Kelly, why doesn't he realize the mailman's never coming in the house? How would he know that? Right? First time the mailman comes up, your dog goes, woo, because someone's at the door. And the mailman leaves. And he's like, whoa, that was cool. The next day, woo, and the mailman leaves. He's like, oh my God, do I got power or what? Right? And every day it's like, woo. Right now he's getting really like, I did my job today, I'm going to go lay on the ground. The reward is the mailman goes away. All the dog knows, behavior got rewarded. Right? Dogs are trial and error learners. Picture two, they are also. Trial and error learners. If the behavior works, they're going to do it again. If the behavior doesn't work, they're just going to try something else. They're going to try until the behavior works for them. But this is true for behaviors we like as well as behaviors we don't like. They learn behaviors work for them, whether you like it or not. Now, because behavior is under the control of its consequences, if we deliberately manipulate the consequences, we can influence the behavior. That's what training is all about, right? We want to reward the dog for doing what we want him to do so he'll do those behaviors again. And by the way, dogs are not trying to be the boss, right? The dominance theory stemmed from really short-term studies on unrelated captive wolves in the 40s. And these scientists put all these unrelated wolves into this big fenced-in area, and they sat there with their little notebooks. And what they discovered is these wolves formed a hierarchy, and they used aggression to keep that hierarchy stable. So the wolf biologists took all these notes and wrote all these papers and wrote books, and the dog people at the time said, oh, if wolves live on a hierarchy, dogs must too. We must be alpha, or they're going to take over the world. All right, so all those old school training methods that were built on dominance really are not really what we need to be doing. Because further research on wolves found, when they finally started researching wolves in the wild in the 70s, they found out that that wolves do not live in a hierarchy. It is a family. It's mom, dad, older siblings, younger siblings. It is a family. It is not alpha. It is mom. And you better listen to what mom tells you to do, right? Just like our families. So those old school dominance theory stuff doesn't even apply to wolves, much less dogs. So take all that and get it out of your head, right? What do dogs need from us? They need understanding and respect for their doggy ways. You might not like the behaviors that dogs do, but you gotta understand that that's who they are. Compassion when they don't understand us, because they don't speak English and they're not human. They need clear communication and guidance so that we can help them learn what we expect from them in our world. And they need trust. They need trust that you're not gonna hurt them. And so these old school punishment-based training techniques of choke chains and shock collars and alpha bulls, it's terrible stuff and it has absolutely no basis in science, right? And they deserve humane treatment, right? I urge you to use positive reinforcement training to communicate with your dog and reinforce the behaviors you like so that they're repeated. If you like something, tell the dog you like it. Right? And ignore or take away the reward for the behaviors you don't like. And so sometimes that's harder to figure out. Like, well, how do I take the reward away? Right? So let's just use the example of a dog that jumps up. Right? Dog jumps on you. What do most people do? No, paw off. Okay? Well, that just rewarded the behavior because you just gave it attention. And if the dog jumps up at you and you punch him, because you're just punishing him, you just punched your dog for saying hello. That's not okay either. What do? Dog jumps, turn around, walk away. Make the jumping chase you away. That's the opposite of what the dog wants. That's what I mean by take away the reward. Figure out why the dog's doing it and take the reward away. And then reward what you want. So the basic behaviors we want to train our dog, sit down, stay calm, watch me, touch, walk with me. These are all the basics. And you should train your dog to do all the basics, not only to have a well-behaved dog, but also because training is fun and it's mentally stimulating for the dog. But we can also train all kinds of stuff. We don't have to stop there. Dogs can learn lots of things, right? All kinds of tricks. This is my little tricks class. Sit pretty. Weave through your legs while you walk. Die on command. Notice his tail was wagging. Yeah. Thank you. Pair the word quiet with the action of shutting up so that they know what it means through Pavlovian conditioning. Then after doing it a dozen or two times, dog starts barking, quiet, they should shut up and run you for a treat. Now you've got an off switch, which is what you need. Now, there are some tools that help barking. Shock collars are absolutely never appropriate. Right? But there are these citronella bark collars. The only time I ever pull a citronella bark collar out is if somebody's in danger of being like evicted or something because their dog won't stop barking. The idea is it's a little canister of citronella, a harmless substance. When the dog barks, it sprays them in the face. They pretty soon learn that happens when I bark. And so it works for a lot of dogs. It doesn't work for some. Some don't care about citronella. And they just bark, and then it empties, and then they're fine. Some dogs have learned, turn their head. Doesn't work on every dog, but it can be helpful at some points. And again, it's pretty harmless. But I like to use some of the other methods first. Okay, so that's barking. What about the digger? Well, first of all, don't leave your dog outside unattended with nothing to do for long periods of time because it's going to entertain himself, right? Increases mental and physical stimulation so he doesn't feel like digging is the only entertainment I get. But also, recognize your dog's need to dig and give him his own digging pit. Lots of clients who have done this, it worked great. Then you just hide their toys and some milk bones and they go there. And once you give them their own digging pit and encourage them and reward them for digging in it, then we try to discourage them from the places we don't want them to dig, like the perennial garden or the vegetable garden, right? There's different devices. This is called the scarecrow, and you hook it up to the hose, and it's got a motion detector in it. This is called the garden ghost, and it just goes, it just sprays out air. It's like the thing you clean your computer with, but it's got a motion detector on the top. Those things can deter the dog from then getting where you don't want them to get. And then if there are active holes, you know, that you don't want them to go keep going back to, fill the hole, but then cover it with chicken wire and put dirt on top of it. And then when the dog starts to dig, they get caught in the chicken wire and like, that's no fun. Go back over to their digging pit. All right? Next behavior problem. Chewing on you. That is fun.
That was fun.
All right? So advice for some chewing. Number one, provide your dog with plenty of appropriate chew toys because they like to chew. So you want to have lots of stuff for them to chew on, lots of variety. Rotate them so they don't get bored. So it's just like kids at Christmas, you know, all excited Christmas Day, and by, you know, New Year's Day, those toys are like worthless. But you've got to rotate the toys so they're always interesting. I also like to spice them up a little bit. If you have a toy they're not paying attention to, soak it in chicken broth overnight. There you go. Now you got more interest in the morning. Okay? And then you can booby trap the stuff you don't want them to chew on. There's bitter apple. I find that bitter apple doesn't work as well as phooey. Phooey is a bitter tasting substance. So dogs chewing on this table. So I spray the phooey. All right, now the dog knows not to chew in front of you, right? It's not safe. You go to work, start chewing on it, and then get icky taste in the mouth. So guess what? Now it's not safe even when you're not home. All right, so that's a booby trap. You can confine the dog when you can't watch the dog, just so that they don't chew until they learn not to chew. If you think your dog's anxious and that's why they're chewing when you're not home, you gotta, again, consider consulting with someone for separation anxiety, because sometimes it is separation anxiety. But I have a lot of people that, now that people know about separation anxiety, they call me up on an appointment. My dog has separation anxiety. And I get to their house and I get a whole history. Does your dog follow you around all the time? No. You know, I ask all these questions that tell me whether or not it's separation anxiety, and then I have to say, I'm sorry to tell you, your dog does not have separation anxiety. Your dog just likes to chew things and learns it's only safe to do it when you're not home. Okay? And so sometimes we're not talking about separation anxiety. Advice for those predatory dogs that like to chase animals. Number one, management. You can't take this out of the dog because it is hardwired behavior. Stems from their genetics, okay? The fact that their ancestors were wolves. So keep your dog on a leash. And so don't let them chase the critters, unless they're not going to do any harm.
I have to be honest, my last dog, you know, he loved chasing the squirrel. He never once in 14 years caught one. But he loved chasing them, and the squirrels were like, think the squirrels got something out of it. So I let him chase the squirrels. What about advice for territorial behavior? Right, number one, again, if they're barking out the window, we use management. Cover the windows or crate the dog when you're not home so they don't keep getting that reward of barking every time someone goes by the house. And then we do counter conditioning. So that's what I just talked about. You stand there and every time someone passes, you pop up a treat. So that the dog learns that passersby predicts treats. Now it only works if you prevent them from seeing them when you're not working on the stuff, on the behavior modification. What about dealing with a scavenging dog? So we got the garbage raiders and the counter surfers. Well, first thing is to recognize that our brain is way bigger than a dog's brain. So why do I tell you this? Because if your dog is getting into the trash, I want you to use your big human brain in the trash where the dog can't get it. It's simple, guys. It's not rocket science. Put it behind the door, lock the cover that it's under, and I literally have people say, no, he should know it's not okay. Well, your brain is about this big. If your dog's a counter surfer, don't leave food on the counter. I mean, it'll make you a lot neater, right? You'll clean the crumbs off the counter. You won't leave the loaf of bread there. Won't leave the butter dish there. I mean, the thing is, don't let them get rewarded for it. So management, using your big, giant human brain. Now, that said, there are some booby traps we could set if you are such that, you know, the kind of person that really wants to teach your dog a lesson rather than use your big brain. So I'll just tell you about the environmental punishment booby traps. So for counter surfing, you make a pyramid of empty soda cans on a piece of cardboard, and the cardboard's sticking off the table a little bit, off the counter. You go, the dog goes and jumps up and hits the end, and all the cans come tumbling down on him. What did it learn? Not safe to get up there, unless your dog really likes soda cans. Your dog's like, cool, soda cans! And now they're all having fun with the soda cans. Then it won't work. This is called a snappy trainer. So this is a good garbage raider tool. It's a modified mouse trap with a big plastic paddle on it. It doesn't hurt. I've had it snap me many times to show people. So you set it in the trash can, cover it with a paper towel, go to work. Dog goes, okay, they're gone. And they go to the trash can and they start rooting around and that thing snaps. What did they just learn? Trash can's not safe. It's about teaching them it's not safe even if you're not there. But again, I prefer that. All right, dealing with the poop eater. If your dog eats his own poop, number one, sometimes dogs have a nutritional issue. You always want to make sure they've got good, healthy, you know, meat-based, grain-free dog food and see the veterinarian, but most of the time it's not that. I just always have to throw that out there. But you can try to, you know, add something to their food, like meat tenderizer or pineapple juice. They make some stuff just for this purpose. One's called Forbid, the other one is called SEP. Stop eating poop. Okay. I usually have people start with pineapple juice, a tablespoon of pineapple juice on their food. They don't mind the taste of the pineapple juice, most of them. But in the digestive tract, the acid in the pineapple juice makes the poo taste icky. So that can help sometimes. But basically, the best way to handle it is to get your dog to clean up properly rather than eat it. So we got to clean up the yard. Management, let access to the litter box. If your dog is getting into a litter box, walk your dog on a leash if they're eating other poop that, you know, that's laying around as you walk. Some other common complaints, jumping on people and pulling on the leash. Why do dogs jump on people? Because our face is way up there, right? And they are overly excited to greet us, and we often reinforce the jumping, especially when they're puppies. We're like, oh, he's so cute. And then when he's 80, it's not cute anymore. Mm-hmm. But you reinforced it through his whole puppyhood. We got to teach puppies not to jump. right? So we never teach them what to do instead. So how do we deal with the jumper? Low-key greeting, so they don't get overexcited and jump all over you. And never reinforce the jumping. Make the jumping chase you away. And then teach them what you want them to do instead. You reward them for sit instead of jump. Okay, what about pulling? Right? Why do dogs pull? They pull, number one, because they're excited to go for a walk, because it's like the 10 minutes a day that you let them do anything they want to do. But dogs also have opposition reflex, which means they pull against pressure. The more pressure they feel in the front of their neck, the more they pull. That's why dogs will choke themselves. And you're like, why are you choking yourself? Right? And again, because you never taught them not to pull. Right? So how do we teach them not to pull? We got to teach them loose leash walking. So you only go forward as long as there's no tension in the leash. As soon as the dog pulls, you stop. Take away the reward. The reward is forward movement. He pulls, you stop. He slackens, you go. He pulls, you stop. He slackens, you go. He pulls, you stop. Pretty soon your neighbors are like, oh my gosh, she's off her rocker. Okay? But then you want to reward the dog with treats for not pulling. So when they have a nice radius around your body, every once in a while you say, good boy, here's a treat. So you reward them for not pulling and you make pulling stop the movement. Okay? Tools that can help with pullers, the front clasping harnesses. The idea is if the leash comes out of the front instead of the back, when there's tension in the leash, it pulls their whole chest sideways and they can't pull as hard. Right? It also helps them slacken so you can start walking. And then the head halters. They're like what horses wear. And the idea is that where the head goes, the body goes. If the dog pulls and pulls their head, they can't keep pulling forward. These require a proper fit and desensitization. Don't just buy one and throw it on your dog. You got to go through a process. These don't. These are great. It's a great thing to start with if you have a puller. The tools you want to avoid. Back clasping harnesses, because that puts the pressure on the front and they're just going to pull against it. And choke chains and pinch collars. Choke chains actually damage the trachea. Remember, they're not going to not pull because you're choking them. They're going to still pull. Pretty soon after years, you damage the trachea. The pinch collar is better than the choke chain, believe it or not, but it also works on the pain principle. It doesn't hurt the trachea, but then it's like digging into them if they pull. They're just tools we don't need when we have humane tools that work better. Okay? So what does your dog need? Your dog needs social stimulation. Remember, they are a social obligate species that can be with you or other animals. But again, they don't need to go to the dog park. The dog park can be problematic. Your dog needs some companionship, and that can just be you is fine. Or the kitty, or the bunny, or the rat, or whatever other animal you might have. They need physical stimulation, aerobic exercise. Remember, a tired dog is a good dog. You've got to get them to run. They need mental stimulation. Most dogs don't get enough mental stimulation. And so we have to provide them with that. And so we give them what we call enrichment. Enrichment feeding is the best way. You feed your dog twice a day. Why feed them in a bowl? I tell all my clients, do not ever feed your dog in a bowl. My dogs have never eaten out of a bowl. All their food they have to work for. Work puzzle feeders. Or I'll take that dinner and wing it out into the backyard and let it forage for it. Right? And then it's half hour finding every little kibble. It's enrichment. What do animals in the wild do? They spend most of their waking hours looking for food. So enrichment feeding provides that mental stimulation along with training, which is also mentally stimulating. And let your dog use his number one sense. Let him sniff things on a walk. Play find-it games with him. Hide treats around the house. Or go to a nose work class. How many of you have ever heard of nose work? This is the newest craze in dog training. I'm going to show you a little video of what a nose work class looks like. This is Jackie, and she is looking for one little teeny treat hidden in one thing. What does this look like?
The dog
dog whining wants his turn. See how she smelled it? Okay, so that's a nose work class. That's really fun stuff. And it is the best class for dogs. They love it. They zonk. I have people send me pictures of the passed out dog in the backseat of the car because it uses so much of their brain power. It's so exhausting. It's like, you know, you go in and take in a real intense class somewhere. Not this one. This wasn't real intense. But I don't think anybody will fall asleep on the way home. All right. So I want you to provide your dog with all of these things, plus the understanding, respect, and guidance they need through positive reinforcement, and you're going to have a great companion. Okay? And that is again, good communication, being able to read that dog and move your own body so you don't threaten the dog, but also lots of food, right? You speak to a dog's heart through their stomach. And so if you want to be somebody the dog really loves, bring really good food. If I was a dog sitter, I would be going into everyone's house with like a bucket of chicken. Not only Colonel Sanders, I mean a little bag of like cut up little pieces of chicken. Yeah. You've got to be something really super special to that dog. You're going into a house, you could be you know, invading their territory, they could be nervous with you until they get to know you. You go in, be non-threatening, happy voice, start chucking food. Throw them chicken.
Yeah.
Okay. And then pretty soon you are going to be part of that. I love that this person comes over.
Yeah.
So our dog loves rides.
Yep.
Short rides.
Yep.
But if we run to a Logan Airport run.
Yep.
She's anxious as can be.
Yeah.
She whines the whole time.
It's probably the speed.
Okay.
So short. The question was, their dog loves short rides, but not like long rides, because just tooling around town, going to the grocery store and stuff, you're probably going 25, 35 miles an hour, maybe 45. But you're on the highway, you're going 75. The car feels different, it sounds different, things are whizzing by their head. It can be really scary. Okay, so one thing is you can put if your car accommodates a crate and your dog's crate trained, put them in a crate and cover it with a sheet. That's one thing you can do. Make sure it's not like motion sickness, because some dogs get motion sickness on a long ride like that, so you can give them Dramamine. All right, works just as well in dogs as it does humans. So there's lots of different ways you can try to figure out, are you motion sick? Is it this? If you can't accommodate a crate, they actually make a little blindfold for dogs called a calming cap. And I use it exclusively for dogs that have car issues. And it's just this little thing. It's like putting a spandex bathing suit on over someone's head. It's like a Speedo on their head. It's really silly looking, but it works. I'm like a charm. Yeah.
It's not a question as much as a comment. I just want to reiterate some of the things Kelly said. Because, you know, at the shelter, we get a lot of stressed out animals. A couple of things. You're right, high-value treats. Milk bones aren't cutting it these days with some of these stressed out animals, the hot dogs, chicken, like you said. The food puzzles, I cannot say enough about. A lot of our volunteers are here too. I mean, it's exhausting, and you guys have always said it's like cramming for a test mentally for them, getting through. You can freeze Kongs, they make all these great puzzle toys. My dog never eats out of a bowl. It's like a wasted opportunity to work them out, and it's great. And also even the nose work stuff. We make boxes of fun at the shelter because we can't take them all out to nose work classes. But, you know, we call them boxes of fun, wrap them up in tape, and they make a little bit of a mess, but it keeps them busy. It can keep them going for an hour, and then they pass out. It's after Thanksgiving, you know.
That's right.
Those are great. They're just amazing tools, and I don't know how people use them.
Yes. I have a two-part question. So my dog's a rescue dog. I've had her for about a year and a half. She doesn't like other dogs, so I want to take her places where there's other dogs, dog parks, you know, hiking, whatever. When other dogs come up to her and sniff her, she immediately sits down to cover her bum from them smelling. And if they are too much, she growls at them and gets like a little like snappy, like she's going to bite them.
Yeah.
So that's part one of my question. And then part two is, if I take her somewhere that she's territorial of, for example, I live across the street from a town common. She doesn't want anyone in her town common.
Right.
I live near Neshoba Winery. I like to go there. She doesn't want anyone at her winery, any of
and
the dogs.
And anyone, meaning people or dogs?
Dogs. She loves people.
Dogs.
Just dogs.
Okay.
I bring her to work with me. I manage an apartment community. We're dog friendly. If other dogs come into the office, it's her office.
Right.
So she bark at other dogs when
right.
she's in places that she thinks are like her places, but then she also doesn't like them.
Right.
So
okay. So first thing is, it sounds like your dog was not socialized to dogs when she was young, and or she had a bad experience with dogs.
I think
either
both.
One of those things can happen. They can also both happen.
Yeah.
Okay. So if a dog's attacked by a dog, they're going to be afraid and defensive to other dogs. And if a dog wasn't socialized to other dogs when they were a puppy, they can be fearful of dogs. Your dog sounds fearful of dogs because she doesn't want to do the doggy thing. Get away from my butt, and if you get too close to me, it's defensive, right? So when your dog is afraid of other dogs, the key is you want to protect your dog and not let these loose dogs, you know, bombard your dog. One thing you can do, go to places where there aren't loose dogs running over and scaring her all the time. The other thing that I tell people to do, and this works for if you walk a neighborhood and there tends to be like loose dogs that come and want to attack your dog, walk with a big giant umbrella, right? And so that you can open it and kind of keep that dog away from your dog. It becomes a shield around your dog. Like, go on. Could you call your dog? My dog's a little afraid. Okay, so that's one. The reason your dog becomes more aggressive in those comfortable places is because that. Because she doesn't like dogs, she's afraid of dogs, but in her places, she feels brave enough to say, get out of my place.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's when we do what we call positive counter conditioning. It's not going to make her love dogs coming up to her and sniffing her, but in order to be in a place where there are other dogs, you carry the chicken. And every time she looks at another dog without, you know, acting crazy, you start feeding her chicken. Like, oh, when you see a dog, you get chicken. So you just do it over and over and over. So pretty soon she's like, hey, there's a dog over there. Do I get chicken? Instead of, oh my God, there's a dog over there. Oh, I gotta act like this.
Right.
It's a little more complicated than that, but that's the simple answer for this kind of a venue. And so just carry food, do counter conditioning, see a dog, get a treat, and then protect your dog.
What if she automatically starts barking the second she sees it? I don't want to give her a treat.
Correct.
Right?
You can distract her with a treat.
Okay.
There's other things that I would do. It's kind of way too detailed to go into here because it was like it would require us to have a behavior consultation.
Okay.
Okay. I'll be glad to answer your questions and send you a protocol if you email me.
Sure.
Okay. But yeah. So
can
a
you
more
one last thing? Can you if she doesn't like other dogs and she's 8 or maybe even older, I don't know. Can I change that around with training, or if she doesn't like them, she doesn't like them? Because I keep trying to make her like
them. She's never going
to
like dogs. Okay. What she can learn is when she sees a dog, she feels okay because she gets treats.
Yeah.
But she's never going to like dogs coming over here. She's way too old and is probably a very deep-seated reason.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I've got 3 dogs in total, but 2 that I walk together. One's a bigger one, about 70 pounds, beautiful, good girl, she's fine. And I have this little, my little love of my life, a little runty dog, about 25 pounds. Hates everybody, hates diesel,
right.
Hates people, hates dogs, hates everything.
Right.
I need to walk them together.
Okay, so I'm going to answer your question, and it's going to tie into your question, but I'm going to answer very quickly. Okay, with the dog, you need to do counter conditioning too. Counter conditioning is feed the dog something extra special in the presence of the things they don't like. But to stop the barking, which we don't want to keep happening because it's self-rewarding, I use that head halter, the gentle leader head collar. Because there's a loop that goes around the mouth, if you gently lift up, it closes the mouth. So the idea is not to punish, not to, but to just lift up, close the mouth, and then when they stop barking, release it and start feeding them chicken again. Okay, so you would need it, but I don't want you to just go out and buy one and stick it on your dog. I want you to, you know, email me, I'll send you protocols and how to get your dog used to it and all that kind of stuff. Okay?
So in the meantime, because I have 2 of them, when they get like that, the little, the big one feeds off the
right,
little one.
Right, that's social facilitation. So you got to work with the little ones in order to change the package.
So they can walk them separately.
That would be great.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I just have a really quick question on the harnesses and leashes. So we have, I have our little rescue Frenchie.
Yep.
He pulls like crazy.
Yep.
So a lot of Frenchie owners swear by those, the front harnesses, not like the one with the strap like you showed, the good one, but the one that you said was bad.
Oh, yeah.
So a lot of Frenchie owners like swear by it. There's whole brands like designated to them. So we also, the second part is we have a little pit mix puppy. So she's with our trainer, works with our trainer right now, and they have her on the, like the plastic prong, like the correction, just to work on the loose leash short term. So I guess I always hear mixed things. So now what we're doing is what you're sort of saying not to do as far as the collars.
Yeah. So I want to just say this.
Yeah.
Ignore everyone else except me.
Okay. I adore my trainer. We love our trainer. Like, this is my third dog.
I love your trainer too, but don't listen.
So I want to know. No. I want to know the right thing to do.
The reason is because, again, everything I just said. The pinch collar works on the pain principle. Your dog is pulling because she hasn't learned not to pull. She's doing what comes naturally. Is it our right to hurt them because they're doing something that comes naturally when we can train them not to do that using causative methods, right? You put a front clasping harness on the dog that changes up the pressure system, and then you really work hard on teaching them. You get rewarded when you don't pull. Okay, and again, I'll send you my, email me, I'll send you my protocol for, you know, I usually have my email on here. Send me, just, everybody just Google me, you'll find me. I'm Google-able. Okay? Front clasping harness and working on loose leash walking and rewarding non-pulling behavior. Okay?
Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome.
I just stopped. My dog is, growly at night.
Yep.
So he's a big friendly dog. Goes in their family room at night. Goes into his dog bed in the corner. And he spends a lot of time in his dog bed during the day too.
Yep.
If anybody moves, or particularly when I was having a holiday dinner, and guests are there, he'll growl at them.
Okay. For one, if you're having a holiday dinner and he tends to get grumpy, put him somewhere else when the visitors are over. Number two, if it seems usually at night, how old is he?
He's 8.
8-year-old dogs are losing a little bit of their senses, their hearing and their eyesight are going. They get comfortable at night. Everything's, the lighting's different. Usually dogs, that, as they get older, they get a little more grumpier at night. If you know that happens, you do counter conditioning. So your dog's over there, and you know if you get this close, he growls. So you get some chicken, you get this close, and you wing the chicken out and walk away. And everyone who walks by, don't trigger the growling. So don't go close enough to trigger the growling. Just throw chicken at him. And so pretty soon he's like, he sees you coming. He's like, chicken, chicken, chicken. And pretty soon then you can get closer and closer and closer. But still, when you have visitors, don't put them in that situation. Okay? You were about ready to say something.
No, just to reinforce, you're walking, to stop. To just stop wherever you are and then go forward when they call.
Correct. Them. Yes. Okay. You have...
I'm a human behaviorist, and my dog's really embarrassing.
Yes.
I'm supposed to know these things. But in terms of, he's got some dogs that he'll play with in the yard, but we want to have another friend over with their dog. He's also leash aggressive, so what's the best way to introduce them?
Yeah, so first of all, you could do counter conditioning on the leash, where you bring that dog into view at a distance, chicken, 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 then he disappears, chicken, disappears, bring him back, chicken, chicken, chicken. You keep doing that until pretty soon he's like so happy to see that dog, and then you get him closer and closer and closer. Or you can go somewhere where there's two yards of the fence in between, so that they can meet off leash, no human involved. Make sure they're going to do okay. But the counter conditioning ahead of time works really well.
Exactly.
Let's go here.
Is there a way to access the pictures that you showed concerning the different postures of the dog? I'd love to show it to my husband.
Yes. So first of all, you can Google all those white pictures that from Stanley Korn's book are all online.
Okay.
If you just put in a Google search, dog body language, you're going to see a ton of stuff that I put up here.
Okay.
Do images, Google images, and a lot of those come up online. They're all from books.
Okay.
So, but nowadays everything's online. So, okay? Yeah.
We each have Great Danes, and they both mount.
Yes. Mount who? You?
They mount other dogs.
than not other dogs.
Yeah, and she has a smaller dog, and one day mine was at the front and hers was at the rear. And this poor little dog.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, the mounting dominance. It's normal dog behavior. It's not necessarily about sex. It is not
dominance.
Even always about dominance, although it can be. It's oftentimes part of play. In this case, your dogs might feel the need that they have to assert themselves through this behavior. Most of the time, I tell people, don't worry about it, because who cares? But humans are so socially embarrassed by humping.
Well, it is. They're big dogs.
And it's like, it's just dog behavior. Now, if they're harassing another dog, you call them off. So if you have a humper who's, is just a harasser, you have to make sure, if he's loose around other dogs, you have an impeccable recall so you can get that dog off of that other dog, because that's not fair. But most of the time, just, who cares? I mean, just let it go. Unless the recipient is looking like, yikes, get this thing off of me.
She just stands.
She's not doing that.
You gotta sit down.
Okay, hang on, she was at her. I know it's hard to know who put their hand up first.
I guess I usually discourage the humping behavior because I'm always worried about it escalating.
Well, it can escalate depending on the relationship of the dogs, or one dog doesn't like to be humped.
Right.
That's why you need to be able to call them off. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Who else? Somebody over here have a hand up that I've been missing? Okay. So, go ahead.
Is your presentation available online? Hard copies?
It is not available online, because if I put it online, nobody would ever hire me to do this. They're recording it. So what are you guys going to do with it?
It's going to be on HCAM TV.
On Hopkinton.
Hopkinton Cable Access.
Oh, there you go. So you guys got my talk. But it's not going to be online. Okay, hang on. So she's hesitant. Some other people have
their hand up. So, context. The Border Collie mix, who spent his 5 years just living in a run in the back garden in Tennessee.
Yep.
Loves the car. Hyper excited.
Yep.
Barks incessantly.
Right.
I've tried stopping and starting the car, but it gets to a point you're on a road.
Yeah, no, that doesn't work anymore.
It's not food motivated.
No.
So
what I would do is what I said here, either put him in a crate, cover the crate.
He's in a crate, in the back, tried covering, didn't work.
Okay. The next thing I would do is you can try some calming remedies, in the car, some pheromone therapy and stuff like that. Or you can try a citronella collar. I mean, again, when we're at our wit's end, it's pretty harmless. It's just that your car's going to fill with citronella, but you won't get any mosquito bites. I would try it, sure. So it's a little blindfold. The Common Cap was developed by a behaviorist in California and then was marketed through one company, and Thundershirt Company just bought the rights to it. So it's now called the Thunder Cap. But it used to be called the Common Cap. You'll find it on no matter what you put in the Google search, you'll find it. And you just got to get them used to wearing it. Again, that's their least, sense. So you cover their vision. They don't really care that much, and it can commonly break down. Okay, so try it.
I run my dog off leash a lot, and she likes the same stuff.
Yeah.
Is putting her back on the leash the way to...
You mean after she...
Or when you catch her in the act.
No. Well, catching her in the act and putting her on the leash probably won't stop her from doing it, because they're compelled to do it. And so it's a hard behavior to punish out of them, okay? Even if the punishment's benign, even if it's, harsh punishment, which isn't appropriate, it might not stop it. Because when a dog is loose and they have free will to do what they want, this is just such a powerful thing that some dogs love to do. So the key is, if you don't like giving your dog a bath after every off-leash walk, you don't give them off-leash walks. Or you just accept the fact that your dog's a roller. My last dog was a roller, right? And I didn't want to give him a bath every time we went out for a walk. So I taught him a very impeccable recall. I see him sniffing something in that way, and that head's about ready to go down, and you dig into it. You call them off. And luckily, most of the time, I was able to catch him. Sometimes he's in the woods. He'd come out and he's got, like, you know, dead animals. So it's bath time. Because I accept my dog's behavior. And so if it's inconvenient to me to go home and give him a bath, oh, well, I shouldn't have a dog. Mm-hmm.
So Lynn's home all day, and I work. And when I come home, Mommy gets all excited. And he automatically disappears, goes upstairs, and takes my pillow or takes whatever I have and destroys it.
So you get home, he's excited, he goes upstairs and destroys your stuff.
Yes.
Huh, interesting. So don't let him upstairs. That was mine. I lost my place. Again, see this big giant brain? So I don't know why he's doing that. So I would just tell him to do it.
Yeah.
Right. So he smells your stuff, he's excited. I mean, a lot of times dogs will pee on your stuff, not because they hate you or the bad, you're trying to get back at you, but because it smells like you, and, you know, they want to mingle their scents, right? Who knows why he's doing it, but don't let him get up there. And teach him to do something else. Okay, when you come home, you're going to teach your dog, go get your ball, or go lay on your mat, or you give him an alternative behavior to do.
Or food puzzle, right?
That would work too. Or walk in a beer. Food puzzle. I would walk in a beer to get coffee.